All things back to school asked and answered with New Hampshire's Commissioner of Education, next on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. The upcoming return to school for New Hampshire marks the third school year impacted by COVID-19. While students are eager to return to in-person learning, a lot of questions remain in these uncertain times. Here to share his guidance on the return to school and answer our questions is Commissioner of the New Hampshire Department of Education, Frank Edelblut. Commissioner Edelblut, welcome.
Happy to join you.
So the last few school years have been unprecedented, to say the least. What have you learned from the past that can help us to prepare this fall?
Well, so they have been unprecedented. And I think that we really all owe a deep debt of gratitude to our educators and our school leaders for helping to navigate through these very uncertain waters. You know, that started back in March 2020, when we knew very little about the COVID and the pandemic and what was in front of us. We navigated through that spring, and then we navigated an entire year throughout the last 2020 and 2021 school year. And now we are in the process of getting ready to enter into our 2021-2022 school year. What we're seeing, and we've learned a lot through this process, and the thing that we know more than anything else, we know how to safely operate school. We know the things that we can do. We know much more about the disease. And so in spite of, you know, new variants that seem to be showing up, we feel very comfortable and confident in our ability to safely educate our students in this next year.
What's been the most challenging part of your job through the pandemic?
You know, I don't really think about the challenges. I mean, there's just a lot of work, right? So there's a constant state of new that you're having to deal with. And some of these are things that we know something about and some are not. And so it's really just a function of, you know, can we dig in? I've got an excellent team here at the department. We've got excellent individuals out in the field. And so as we dig in to what those new issues are and those new problems that we face, we all just collectively trying to figure out how to solve them and roll out some plans. You know, the goal is not perfection. We know that, again, with all of this new stuff, that we might try some things and we say, like, that's not going to work. We're going to have to try something different. But because people recognize that, they've been very flexible and forgiving. And that is not just really here at the department and in our school systems, but from our families as well, as, you know, the school systems are figuring out and we're figuring some stuff out. But again, coming back full circle to that main message of, we know how to conduct safe in-person instruction for our students. And that's really what our objective is for this year.
Let's talk a little bit about the importance of for New Hampshire students to be able to return to traditional in-person schooling.
So we learned and we got a lot of data last year around how students were performing and how they were doing throughout that kind of tenuous time of whether it's in person or hybrid or remote. What we know is that most students do well in an in-person instructional environment. There are a small percentage of students who do well in that remote environment. You know, those students seem to like the agency and the autonomy that they're able to exercise, and that has helped them quite a bit, even in their mental health areas, but in other areas, because of the social isolation of students through the quarantining or the remote instruction, it is, you know, the students have paid a price for that, right? And they have, you know, experienced some difficulty as a result of that. So we know that, you know, psychologically it's good for students. We also know really academically that many of our students struggled during that time. We've got a preliminary look at our assessment results, not finalized yet, but it looks like the trends from across the country are that, you know, in the English language arts area, students pretty much held their own, not a lot of gains, and that the slippage is going to be mostly isolated to the mathematics area. So again, we've learned a lot. We know it's important for students to be with one another, to have those social interactions. And so we're looking forward to getting back in this year.
Have you looked at plans yet to sort of address that slippage in the areas of math, or is that not quite focused yet of getting through this year?
No, that has been a big part of the work that both we've been doing here at the Department of Education, as well as the work that is taking place in our districts. We received a significant amount of federal funding, which is referred to as kind of COVID response funding, to help us make sure that we're able to fill in the gaps that have resulted as a result of the pandemic. So really starting back in the spring, we were already planning for how we could continue to help students make progress, both academically as well as the whole child making progress. One of the first programs that we rolled out this summer was a program called Rekindling Curiosity. The goal was to allow more students to get to camp. And that might seem a little bit strange that we're advocating camp as opposed to an academic program, but really the students have had a tough year. They needed some time with their peers. They needed some time to get out and decompress and get themselves excited about life and about learning again. We wanted to make sure that we rekindled that curiosity so that when they showed up in September, they were excited to be back in school with their peers and learning again. And then following on with that, we've created tools, invested in technology to make sure that every one of our students has an opportunity to succeed. Two programs that I can highlight as well are the Canvas Learning Management System. So we've invested in technology that helps make sure that all of our teachers really have the right kind of tool and structure and framework to be able to conduct their classes through a learning management system. And this is the kind of system that, while it can be used for remote, is really designed for in-person instruction and making sure that all of the coordination and the activities around that instruction take place. We then took that tool and we populated it with some resources from an organization called Discovery Education. Discovery Education is part of, or a spin out of, Discovery Channel, which many people know. They have curated all of that Discovery Channel content, as well as content from over 100 other providers, and made that available and organized it in a way that's very accessible for students to be able to, and for teachers to be able to access. So essentially what I like to think of that program as is we've eliminated kind of the have and have nots. Every educator in New Hampshire now has a good, solid learning management system platform. Every educator in New Hampshire now has high quality instructional materials that they can integrate into their instructional environment. So trying to eliminate some of the things that might prevent some of our students from succeeding. And there's another program, if I may, and if I'm going on too long, just cut me off. We got a lot going on.
Oh, the big question. Parents want to hear about this.
Okay, that was a very large question. We have another program called Yes, Every Student. And this is really an interesting program, again, to help students fill in gaps. And it is available. So it's got a couple of different aspects to the program. But one of the aspects of the program is for our students who are in our public schools, that the parent may believe that they need some extra tutoring or something, through the Yes, Every program, Every Student program, they're able to, we will fund kind of a digital wallet, and they can hire a New Hampshire certified educator to be able to provide tutoring services to them. And so again, just trying to help them find ways to close the gap on that learning. So the schools will be doing a lot of work, but we're also putting the tools directly into the hands of parents to help their students respond.
The tutoring program, will there be anything available for families who may not be able to afford to hire a tutor through that?
So through that tutoring program, we're actually providing the funds to them up to $1,000 to be able to hire tutors. So the actual program itself funds the families to be able to hire the tutors to close that gap. But because you mentioned it, I will lean in on another program that we started in the fall of last year. We started working on it in the fall. We actually launched in January, I believe. And this is schoolhouse.world, which is a free peer-to-peer tutoring service that we set up, working with SalCon and Khan Academy to be able to roll out to all of our families. So again, students who are struggling, we've created a lot of safety net types of programming to be able to make sure that we can catch them and catch them up so that they can stay on their trajectory for learning and have success.
So along that same line, what is being done to help English language learners and special education students?
Yeah, so that is a big question. And I'm going to kind of take it in two parts, both for our English language learners as well as for our special education students. You know, one of the things we found for our English language learners last year, as we were conducting instruction throughout the year, was the importance of getting them strong supports. And so we rolled out a program working in partnership with many of our nonprofits in the state to be able to provide that support. And that included, you know, even porch visits, we refer to them as, you know, going out to homes and helping students to be able to get connected to their instruction, making sure that if they needed help, we were able to do that for them, helping to navigate the families through some of the processes for accessing instruction, how they can help their students by following up on assignments to make sure that the work is actually being done. That program was so successful that we continued that into the summer and then into the fall to make sure that the English language learner families and students get some little extra support to help them not fall behind in any way. And then, of course, those students as well are engaged in many of the other learning support programs that we have. And then relative to special education, we've done a couple of things. Again, thinking about where we came out of last year, we knew that our students were going to need some extra supports. We knew that some of our students were not able to receive the kinds of supports that they need in order to be able to successfully engage and access their education. So we provided a program to provide compensatory services to all of our districts. So any student that needed some extra support to help get caught up, we were able to fund that for them. So the districts would identify those students who needed those extra supports, and we would actually be able to pay for it so that they would do that. And we will continue that work into the fall to make sure that all of our students, you know, whether they're English language learners, students with disabilities, are able to get the supports. Well, another interesting aspect of the programs that we mentioned earlier, so for example, recovering our Rekindling Curiosity, which was our camp, our summer camp program that we mentioned just a moment ago. So when we made we put those programs together, we allocated certain funds to students, but students with disabilities received an extra allocation because we know sometimes they need extra supports in terms of accessing that type of programming. And that same holds true for our students with disabilities. So if they go to the Yes Every Student Tutoring Program, the qualifying criteria for participation is really their disability. There's not another income, you know, level or means testing for that, for them to access it, because we know that students with disabilities are going to need extra supports and we want to be there to help support them.
So shifting a bit, the Massachusetts State Board of Education has just voted to require all public K through 12 students and staff to wear masks, at least until early October. Education Commissioner Jeff Riley said, well, the safest in this path forward is to mask up in schools. The CDC also recommends indoor masking for people age 2 and older. So with so much uncertainty around the Delta variant, what guidance are you giving New Hampshire school districts who are being told they need to make their own decisions about regulating masks and safety protocols?
Yeah, so that is a great question. And what was really interesting is I actually had breakfast with Jeff Riley, who is the Secretary for Education in Massachusetts yesterday before he went and did that press conference. So we had lots of conversation around that particular policy and what that looks like both in Massachusetts and in New Hampshire, which in many ways is very different than Massachusetts and the environment that they are operating within. One of the things that I make sure that I emphasize when we think about how to conduct safe instruction is the idea of a layered approach. You know, we've talked about this many different times. It is not one single mitigating strategy that is going to allow us to be successful, but a layered approach to that. You know, for example, we know about vaccines and how can we, help to encourage vaccination status for those families where that is appropriate. We also know the importance of, you know, keeping sick children out of our learning environment. That is probably one of the most important, you know, mitigating factors we can do. We know that if a sick child stays home and doesn't come to school, they are not going to be infecting their classmates. And so that would be a mitigating strategy that is eminently important. We know about social distancing. We understand about cohorting. And we understand about masking. What we have to be careful of is that we don't imagine that one particular mitigating factor is going to solve the problem for the whole state. And as well, we have to recognize the great degree of variation we have in our different learning environments. And the example that I sometimes like to use is if I were to go to one of my more urban elementary schools as an example, you know, they may have very low vaccination rates in their community compared to maybe one of my other districts that has higher vaccination rates. In those same, urban, elementary school, you may find that they don't have the capacity or the ability to socially distance in that particular learning environment. And maybe one of my other school districts, even when their building is full, they have the ability to socially distance. In terms of parental screening, we may find some school districts have been able to implement that in a way that families are very diligent and focused in terms of trying to make sure they're screening their children, and other communities where that may not be so. And so that's another mitigating factor. So you really need to look at all of these mitigating factors in totality and craft a safe reopening plan for your community, and not assume that a singular policy across the state is going to make the difference in terms of how that plays out.
And even built in, my next question kind of built into what you're sort of talking about, there are different vaccination rates, those layers have different levels of participation around the state, whether it's vaccinations or people wanting to wear masks. And so there's a lot of division, especially among parents, regarding in-person schools and masks. So how do you navigate that?
Yeah, so I think the first place to begin navigating is to, and I've had this conversation, the emphasis, it's really interesting, because even in this line of questioning that in the conversation we're having right now, what did we hone in on? We focus primarily on masks as the mitigating factor that is going to make all the difference, when there are a lot of other mitigating factors that have to be in that conversation. So it would be inappropriate to only have a conversation and information relative to one mitigating factor without taking into consideration the totality of the conversation and of the mitigating factors in that community. The second aspect, and I think this is really important because, as you pointed out, there's a lot of individuals on both sides of the equations relative to that one mitigating factor that generates a lot of anxiety in some of these communities. And I think the number one thing that we need is we need to make sure that all those parent voices are heard. It doesn't mean that we're going to be able to make everyone happy in every single circumstance, but we do need to make sure that the parents have a voice in the process. It's when we don't allow people to have a voice that it tends to increase the levels of frustration and not bring us to satisfactory conclusions. I was speaking with a superintendent yesterday who is in charge of a large district, quite frankly, and he's not experiencing that kind of acrimony that you've sort of described there. In fact, he described it as he has crickets in his community. He's been transparent. He's got lots of input. It doesn't mean that everybody got what they wanted, but they all had an opportunity to help formulate not the decision on one particular mitigating strategy, but how the whole school district would come together to safely provide instructions for students, which is what we really all want to see happen.
And sort of as a follow-up to that, so the NEA wants faculty and staff fully masked and vaccinated, so taking two of those mitigating factors. Do you think that this is a realistic expectation?
Well, so it was interesting because the position has kind of changed over time. And I think that that's appropriate, like the circumstances change. And I do know that just recently they came out relative to wanting to mandate vaccinations for those educators. I think that what we have to do is we have to respect the individual's rights in terms of the decisions that they are going to be making. And in fact, the legislature's even weighed in with a statute that allows individuals to make choices around their vaccinations and their vaccination status, particularly in that public domain. And so we have to respect the law that the legislators have brought to us, and we have to respect the individual rights of our educators to make decisions about what they're going to be doing. Bearing in mind that last year, we had in-person instruction through some of our highest case count times in that late fall without vaccinations, with other mitigating factors, 5 days a week of in-person instruction, both in our public schools as well as many of our non-public schools were able to do that. And so we know that it can be done. And so we feel confident that we've only made progress up to this point in time, and we can continue to do that. We're in a very different circumstance here today than we were last year.
And Do you foresee having to go back to that sort of hybrid model? Do you think that that will happen this year? What are you looking out for in that regard?
So we do not anticipate that. And even working with public health, much of the guidance has changed. Now, I understand everybody's looking at this and imagining that this is like last year, but it's not. So what we will be doing in our education environment is students who are sick, we're going to ask them to stay out of that environment, whether they have COVID, and that's the nature of their illness, or they don't have COVID. But even if they are confirmed COVID, we are not in a circumstance now where we will be quarantining those individuals who are close contacts or those individuals who are also in that classroom. We will have continuing instruction in that learning environment, and we will ask everyone to continue to monitor themselves for any type of symptom. And if they become symptomatic, whatever the illness is, we're going to ask them to exclude themselves from that learning environment. And the only exception to that really is around close household contacts. So if you're living with someone who has COVID, the public health guidance around that is that they should be quarantining. And so that will be in place. But otherwise, we don't see the significant disruptions to our instructional model this year that we experienced last year.
Now, switching to a different topic, there is a bus driver shortage in districts across the state, and many are warning that rides to school may take longer than in the past or routes canceled altogether. There may also be a shortage of drivers willing to take students to sports or extracurricular events. So why is there a bus driver shortage, and what are school districts doing to address it? And is there anything the state can do to help with that?
Yeah, so there has been a bus driver shortage pre-pandemic. I don't know if you remember this, but I think it was Northwood or Norwood, I'm not sure which one, had a bus driver shortage at the beginning of their school year, and they had to defer the opening of school. This was before the pandemic started. We haven't experienced anything as acute as that these days, but we are a state with very low unemployment numbers. It is difficult to recruit people in any field, whether that is in bus drivers or healthcare workers or even in the Department of Education. And so we are trying to actively recruit those. The bus drivers problem is a little bit exacerbated because that population who drives buses oftentimes were individuals who are retired and therefore maybe more at risk relative to the symptoms or the issues associated with COVID. But because we've been able to roll out the vaccination, we've been able to eliminate that barrier. And then just recently, we've been working with the Department of Safety to allow a more expedited process for qualifying drivers vis-a-vis their background check. And so we expect that to help a little bit. But otherwise, it's really an all hands on deck process of trying to identify as many qualified drivers as possible and deploy them. Many of our bus companies and even our school districts are offering a variety of financial incentives, including signing bonuses and other types of incentive plans to employees to be able to entice them to come to work and drive our students. I have not heard of any district yet that will result in the inability to transport students to their school. And as you point out, the place where you might see the more disruptive aspect of this is around those extracurricular activities if we have difficulty getting bus drivers to handle those other bus runs as opposed to the normal stuff. In the process, we will prioritize getting our kids to school for instruction. That will be the number one goal.
Switching now to food, a lot of accommodations were made over the last year to help students access proper nutrition while at home or in hybrid learning. Will there be similar accommodations kept this fall?
Yeah, so we just should all be proud of the job that our food service personnel did this last year. They served, I think, over 5 million additional meals through that process. They did an incredible job. As we return to school now, we imagine that we are returning to our normal food programs. So we have a variety of programs that support students who need that type of support, financial support for food. Those are in place and students are eligible to participate in those. So we see that happening, but we don't see the need to have the supplementary and the additional food programming that we had to have last year when the instruction was so disrupted.
And finally, as a parent yourself, what would one of your main concerns be sending students back to school in person this fall? And how would you talk about those? How would you address those?
So I think that the one thing, and again, that's a great question, by the way, and not one that I anticipated that you were going to ask me, but I will reflect as a parent myself, right? And I think it's really going to be important. You know, students are going to be coming into that learning environment having had a variety of experiences outside of that school, right? Many of those students were back in class already this spring, so they do know that aspect of it. So what you're going to find is in terms of the learning, there's going to be a wide variation. You know, some kids will have accelerated, some kids will have fallen behind, some kids might be really nervous, some kids are not worried at all. And so what I would ask all of our students and all of our educators to be sensitive to is just respect that those children are coming from different places, and just allow them to come from those places. Don't set expectations about how they should behave, how they should respond. And when I say how they should behave, of course they have to have good behavior, but they might be tentative, they might be nervous. So just be patient with one another, be flexible with one another, and I think we can have a wonderful year in 2021 and 2022.
New Hampshire Commissioner of Education, Frank Edelblut, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm really looking forward to this school year.
The conversation continues online, and we want to hear from you. How do you feel about your children going back to school? Visit our Facebook page and share your story. And thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.